Hello everyone, welcome to another lecture of Psychology of Programming. My name is Feline Hermans from Leiden University, and in this course the goal is, maybe you forgot this or maybe you're just tagging along in the middle of the course, the goal is to give people tools to think about how you would compare a programming language A with a programming language B. Imagine you have to make a decision, which of these programming languages is better? How would you even think about that question? That is the goal of this course in general. In the last lecture that we had, we talked about cognitive dimensions, and the homework was to select a programming language and to analyze it in terms of different cognitive dimensions. So the focus of the last lecture we had was very much talk about programming languages, A and B, or maybe just one that you analyzed, so just A and not B. The goal of today's lecture specifically is to go back again to deciding what programming language could be better. So it isn't about one specific domain, it isn't about one specific programming language, it's general, how would you decide which is better? So it's a little bit more about research methods than it is about the technology of programming languages. Quick recap of something we talked about in an earlier lecture, that we had these three different ways of doing science. There's studying the world as it is, that we do in natural sciences, or in Dutch, the beta sciences. But there's also the social sciences that mainly study people. And then there's the humanities, or alpha, as we say in Dutch, that mainly study the things that people produce, like music or artifacts or books. Today's lecture, we're going to look at things from the humanities, but then applied in the computer science domain. So the topic of today is corpus analysis. And this is a research method that's very commonly used in the humanities, where you look at books or newspaper articles or other texts that people have produced, and you try to learn from a big volume, a big corpus of texts that are human created. The lecture today will give an overview of corpus analysis in the context of linguistics, let's say the original context, and then later on we're also going to look at how that reflects on computer science research and how programming languages can also benefit from understanding how corpus analysis works. But actually, before we're going to go look at the linguistics, we're going to look at maybe the first, I can't say for sure if it's the absolute first person that have applied this in computer science, but probably one of the first people that tried to do something like corpus analysis without using that terminology was Donald Knuth, that you might know as the creator of the LaTeX programming language, or the LaTeX type system programming language. Of course, it's an interesting question whether or not LaTeX should be seen as a programming language. He wrote a paper that we talked about earlier already in the course, The Errors of Tech, in which for 10 years he analyzed what mistakes he made himself. So this is something you could classify as a diary study, where he wrote down his own experiences in lots of detail. But in addition to this work, he also did a work that you could consider a corpus analysis. That's this paper, An Empirical Study of Fortran Programs. And you might think, Fortran programs, how did he analyze this? Did he maybe have floppy disks or hard drives on which these programs were stored? But it's even longer ago. It's even different from what you might expect. He actually analyzed 250,000 punch cards. And in case you don't know exactly what a punch card is, this is a punch card. So before people programmed using textual programming languages, they programmed with punch cards in which you could punch holes, and then each hole corresponds to a specific programming construct in a programming language or a variable. So you would punch out the right holes, put it in a machine, and this way your programming language would, or your program in a given programming language like Fortran, would be executed. And allegedly, again, I'm not entirely sure if this is a made-up legend or it actually happened, but allegedly, he even went around campus and stole punch cards from trash cans to add to his big pile of punch cards to analyze. At least, if it's not true, it is an interesting and fun story. This is a snippet from the paper. I will link to the original paper on Blackboard. And you can see that at least he was trying to have a broad scope of the programs that he analyzed, because he looked at student programs from Stanford, but he also had programs from industry, from a company called Lockheed. So he also tried to compare what do students do and what do people within companies do, and are there differences? So there was some broad representation at least attempted, but of course it was also a matter of what he could get his hands on, because he was at Stanford, so it was easier to get programs there. With those punch cards, he studied how Fortran was used in practice and by students. For example, here's another snippet from the paper that says most do loops were quite short, involving only one or two statements. So he has a table here of how many statements are in the loop and how often that occurred within his big data set. The goal of this wasn't necessarily to understand how people were programming, though. The goal was more to improve the compiler. So he was interested in those programs because he thought, well, if I understand what people do with Fortran, then I could improve a Fortran compiler. For example, in the highlighted line, you can say that he says, well, very often there are blank columns in the punch card, so you could skip over them and that would actually improve performance. So even though his goal wasn't necessarily to understand how people program, but still the technical goal of improving a compiler, this could very well be seen as one of the first attempts at doing corpus analysis within computer science. But as I referred to earlier as well, he didn't really use this terminology, and it also doesn't really look like he was aware that he was using a research method that's well established in linguistics and applied some ideas from that research method into computer science. It sort of seems to be happening accidentally. He was like, oh, here are some punch cards, maybe in the trash can. Let me see what comes out so I can improve the compiler. Even though it wasn't really the goal, it is still a very clear example of humanities-like research, of alpha-like research, because what is being studied here isn't nature as it is, isn't the world as it has already existed, and it also isn't necessarily behavior of people. What is studied is stuff that people have created. So that very much fits in the typical research methods that can be seen as humanities research. And then if we're going to do research from the humanities domain, you could say it is our responsibility as computer scientists to also understand how should you do that, to understand what are the best practices that are being used typically in linguistics, what can we learn from those best practices, and how can we apply them to computer science research such that we don't end up making mistakes or reinventing the wheel about research methods that are well established outside of our field. So the rest of the goal of this lecture is really to help you understand how would you typically do corpus analysis, what do people in linguistics already know about how to apply this research method, and then how can this be applied to computer science. For example, things that are very important in linguistics is to consider sampling. If you are going to look at a body of work, let's say the entire oeuvre of Shakespeare, then you make a decision there. You're going to say, I want to have the entire oeuvre. I want to have everything he's ever written, maybe including small stories, including poems, everything there is. That's what I want to include. You want to make a clear decision. You can also say, my decision is I'm going to study all newspaper articles in the Netherlands from 1981. For example. But you have to make a clear decision of what am I going to include and what am I going to exclude. And here you already see, if you compare this to the study that Donald Knuth did, that's a bit, he just used what he could get his hands on and he wasn't specifically very deliberate about what to include about or what to exclude, apart from the fact that he did want to try to include at least more than just students from Stanford. Something else that's very important is to think of the things you are sampling in terms of representation. You want to get a fair overview of what you are looking at. For example, again, if you say I want to have newspaper articles from 1981, then one newspaper might have a specific view of the world. So you want to have maybe at least 5 different newspapers to get a broader selection of what you're doing. Or maybe in terms of authors, you want to say, well, I want to have a few young authors and a few older authors, or I want to have male and female authors, or I want to have black people and white people in my sample because I'm interested in all people or on all people of a certain age. So if you're selecting, you want to make sure that your representation is fair. And again, here, Donald Knuth was at least trying to have a broad selection of both students and industry, but of course it was just one university and then a top university at that. And also it was just one company. So there you again see that representation was thought about, but not necessarily deep, maybe not necessarily deep enough. A third aspect that you really want to look at is balancing. So you want to be aware of overrepresentation. Imagine again that you are analyzing all books by a certain author, and one of his books is very thick, it's like 1,000 pages, and one is just 100 pages. You could say, I'm sampling those two books, and that's fair because there are two books in there. But then of course the very large book with lots of pages will overshadow the smaller book. So in that case, sometimes you say, well, I have one book of 100 pages, and then from the book of 1,000 pages, I might randomly select 100 pages or want to make a smart selection, because otherwise one book will overshadow the entire corpus. And this is something you also have to be aware of, that there's balance in your corpus, because one book might overshadow other smaller books. And this can also, of course, be true if you're comparing multiple authors and one author has written twice as many books as the other author, then you also want to balance out, because otherwise, of course, you can't really make a fair comparison. So balance is important in the selection of your corpus. Elements of a corpus are often tagged. So books, especially books by famous authors, there exists the book itself, but very often there's also a richer version that has metadata of the book that is easier to analyze. And you can think of, for example, things that can be tagged is you have a newspaper and the headline is tagged with a tag, this is headline. Or books can also often be tagged with part of speech analysis. So you have the regular text of the book, but there's also tagging that says this is a noun and this is a verb and this is an article. So you don't have to do that analysis yourself. You can already easily filter out, give me all the nouns or give me all the articles of this book. So it's easier to do analysis. And often there's also metadata at the document level. So sometimes you also know for a newspaper article, for example, what newspaper did it appear in, when, on what page of the newspaper, who wrote the newspaper article. This is tagging at the document level. If you're doing corpus analysis in linguistics, these are often the things that you get for free. Well, of course, someone analyzed it for you, but this is typically already part of a corpus. There are different types of corpora. For example, there is a general corpus. This is a corpus we don't really know anything about, so this can again be newspapers or books, general. But there's also specialized corpora. And for example, an example of a specialized corpus can be manuals for TVs. This is a very specific genre of text that you might want to be interested in comparing this to other manuals of radios or manuals of toasters. So sometimes you have a very detailed corpus, and in many cases this can be used in collaboration with each other. And a third form of a corpus is a learner corpus. And this is a specific corpus in which you have texts that aren't produced by professional writers, that aren't even produced by writers, but are produced by people that are learning the language. So these can be children that are learning their first language, but it could also be second language learners. And this, again, presents a different view on a language, because people that are learning might make different mistakes, might make interesting mistakes, from which you can gain more insight in the language. These, as I already said, can also be compared. Especially, it can be very interesting to compare the types of mistakes children or learners make to general, because sometimes mistakes that children make do end up in adult proficient readers also still make the same mistakes. So it can be interesting to see how sometimes language changes based on people learning the language. This is also true for people that are learning their second language. Sometimes this influences language in a certain way. So these types of corpora often are used in comparison with each other, where you look at, hey, the specialized corpus, when is it like the general corpus, or the learner corpus, when is it like a more generic corpus? And of course, there's the exam ego. As always, even if this is a remote lecture, this is something that might end up in the exam. So give an example of a specialized corpus, give an example of a learner corpus, and why you would want to compare these different things. This is something that might end up being asked in the exam. A fourth form of a corpus is a so-called parallel corpus. And a very, very famous example of a parallel corpus that you might have already thought about yourself is Rosetta Stone. This is the same text in different languages. This is why it's called parallel. There are also more modern examples. For example, Canada has both English and French as an official language of the country. So many documents of the Canadian government are available exactly the same in French and in English. And this can also help people compare language use across different languages, because of course there might be small variations between the languages that might be interesting. There is also, in addition to Rosetta Stone, a website that you might want to be interested to check out that's called Rosetta Code. So Rosetta Code is meant to be a parallel corpus of programming languages. It has a long list of different types of programming challenges, and people, just volunteers, you could also submit answers to those challenges in different programming languages to allow researchers to look at how do programming languages differ and how do you solve these type of programming challenges in different programming languages. So that is accidentally, again, I think they might not realize they are a parallel corpus, but it's definitely an example of a small parallel corpus in the domain of programming languages. We have already hinted at it, but what do people in linguistics typically do with a corpus? Of course, there are many, many different things you could do, but things that are common are, for example, understanding culture, specifically understanding subculture. So questions like, do female authors use different words from male authors? Do black authors use different words from white authors? Do younger people pick up different language trends that used to be considered as mistakes or as improper language, but are now getting popular because of a certain age group that uses it? And another thing that people do with a corpus is also to inform teaching. If you see that children, learners, are struggling with a certain concept and keep struggling with a certain concept for a very long time, that might also mean that if you're designing a curriculum, you need to spend time on this. And one example in Dutch, for example, is that people that aren't Dutch, raised in a Dutch-speaking family, have a very hard time to understand the difference between de and het. We have two different articles in Dutch. We don't just have the word de, we have het and de. And it's very hard to know which is which. You basically have to memorize all the words and know if they're male or female or neutral to be able to select the right article. We know this is very hard, and you can deduct that. Well, you could deduct this from asking people what is very hard, but you could also see it, hear it in their speech and see it in their writing, that this is a concept that is very, very hard to grasp, and that might inform teaching. And then you know, this is something I have to spend a lot of energy on as a teacher, because it's something that can really linger for a long time, and it takes a really long time to memorize all the words and to always know the right article. So if you look at written texts or spoken texts by people that are learning, this might help you to understand how to better teach, because it can help you understand what concepts are really difficult. In previous lectures, we talked about two different types of research. Firstly, deductive research, where you have a theory and you want to confirm the theory with a hypothesis. That's very common in the natural sciences. But there's also inductive research, which is creating a theory based on observations, and this could also be done in corpus analysis. Corpus analysis can be done inductively, but also deductively. Sometimes you go into a corpus with a specific research question that you want answers, but in other situations you don't really know what you're looking for, but you can still gain something from looking at a big corpus of text. Participation panda time. This means you have to start thinking about something. Pause the video if you need a little bit of time and try to think of one deductive and one inductive study that could be done using corpus analysis. So I hope you came up with really nice and lively examples. I'm sort of sorry to lecture through video, because otherwise we could have a nice discussion in class. But now this discussion just has to take place on Blackboard. It is what it is, sadly. Things you might have thought about in deductive research is the theory that based on some observations that you might already have had, that women, for example, use the word like more than men. This is a theory that you could confirm by looking at a written or a spoken corpus of male and female authors or TV presenters or whatever the source of your corpus is. There's a clear example of a deductive research question that starts with a hypothesis that you're going to verify or refute if you don't find a difference. An inductive study along the same lines could be where you're just interested in the differences between male and female authors. You don't really know what the differences might be. These differences might arise from doing corpus analysis. So these are just two examples in the realm of linguistics of a deductive and an inductive study, both based on a corpus, potentially even based on the same corpus. As I said in the beginning of the lecture, corpus analysis is also a very lively topic in computer science. It is something that's quite commonly done, analyzing corpus analysis, but then they're not analyzing a corpus of text, but they're analyzing a corpus of computer source code. Instead of called corpus analysis, often this field in computer science is called mining software repositories. And with a repository here, they mean something like a GitHub repository in which programmers around the world share their source code in an open and online way. This looks very much like corpus analysis, but it's typically called mining software repositories. And here you see this is the website of the conference that's held annually. I don't know for how many times, but at least already a decade. Every year there's this conference about mining software repository, which shows us that many researchers are working on this area. There are lots of similarities between mining repositories and corpus analysis, but there's also differences. One of the differences is that a repository is typically richer than just text and just source code. For example, many repositories on GitHub, for example, also have bugs. So if you go to a GitHub repo, this is one of the repos that I host, these are all issues that people have opened. So they say, hey, here's this thing about your source code that isn't exactly perfect. Maybe you should fix that. And then you can even, if you're changing your source code, if you're committing your source code, you could say this commit fixes that bug. So there's a linkage also between a bug and code that fixes the bug. And that gives rise to a whole subfield of mining software repositories that's entirely focused on understanding how are bugs fixed, when are bugs fixed, because you have this traceability of when a bug is fixed, by who and with what source code. Sampling in mining software repositories isn't considered as, let's say it doesn't follow all the best practices that linguists would tell you you should follow. For example, almost everything that's being analyzed is open source data because open source data is there. And the sampling process very often is, oh, we analyze the top 10 or the top 50 repositories. I will admit that I have also written papers that say, oh, we picked the top 50 projects on GitHub and that's where we do our analysis. Of course, it's nice to pick projects that are popular, but also there you do have all the risks that linguists warn you about, that maybe one of the projects is really big and the bugs of that project might overshadow all the smaller projects. And in terms of representation, source code on GitHub that is open source that people often work on voluntarily might have really different characteristics from software that is written within large-scale companies. So sampling doesn't always follow the best practices that you would want to follow, sometimes because people aren't that well trained in these type of research methods. That's one of the goals that I have for this course, that a new generation of computer scientists has a bit better understanding of these research methods, but also sometimes just because the data that is there, and it would be a shame not to analyze it. So yeah, why not take the top 50 GitHub projects? It's a tough thing to get right, but at least it's something to be aware of, that sampling is harder. A third thing that is very different in repository mining versus corpus analysis is that lots of the code that we analyze, we don't know who wrote it. If you're analyzing books and newspaper articles, then you know who wrote it. And of course, also in linguistics, often there are texts that we don't know who wrote them, especially older texts, like in the ancient times, we don't know who wrote everything. But in more modern times, we know exactly who wrote it. And if you have a Shakespeare book, you know from what century he is. You know, he is male, you know where he grew up, in what area of England. There's lots of extra information you have about more modern authors. And especially this is, of course, true for people that wrote books in the previous, let's say, 50 years. You know exactly where they grew up, you knew, who they interacted with, and what the effect of that might be on their literature. Whereas if you sample source code from GitHub and Dragon Dave 65 committed to your repo, who is Dragon Dave? Where does he live? Is English his first language? Is he even a man? You don't know this. You don't always have a good background of people that are contributing code. And that makes it really harder to do the type of analysis in terms of what do men write different source code from women? Do older people write different source code from younger people? Because there's not a real reliable way to tell who actually wrote this source code. One of the future guest lectures that we will have in this course, we will have a video about how tricky it is to try to guess people's gender from their GitHub profile to enable you to do research into programming and gender. If we look at the typical research questions in linguistics again, understanding culture, informing teachers, you will see that the goals in computer science in mining repositories are often different. Different research questions are being answered. For example, because we have bug information, understanding bugs and understanding fixes is something that's very commonly done. Also, of course, because it's important to understand how are bugs created and how are bugs fixed, because one of the goals of computer science research is to make software that has fewer bugs. Another line of research questions within computer science is doing corpus analysis to improve programming languages. Very much like the first study we had at the beginning of the lecture by Donald Knuth, the goal there was to improve the Fortran compiler, and by looking how people use Fortran, you gain a better understanding of how to build a better compiler. This is also true for many APIs. So if you create an API or a library or a framework, you might be interested in how do people use this framework? Because often, of course, people use your framework in ways you didn't anticipate. So improving programming languages, but also APIs, libraries, frameworks, is a common goal of computer science mining repository research also. The homework for this week, if you're interested in doing the homework because you're following this course in Leiden, is to study the best practices in corpus analysis. I put a resource on Blackboard, a book chapter where you can read in more detail the things I talked about in this video. What are the best practices of how to do corpus analysis? Then your next step is to study one paper. You can randomly pick any paper from the Mining Software Repositories Conference 2019 that I've also linked on Blackboard. Just pick a title that you're interested in. And I want you to reflect on corpus analysis. So how do people in the mining software repository community, how do they follow the best practices that you should follow if you're doing this type of research? So reflect on this. Specifically, there are a little bit more guidelines on Blackboard, specifically on what is the research question, what type of research is being done, how is sampling done, what are they actually looking at, is this a fair sample, is this the best sample, is this what you would pick if you would do this research. That is the homework for this week. Good luck. Thanks for watching the video. I hope everyone is healthy and safe and moderately happy and able to work on their homework as more or less as scheduled. See you in the next lecture.